Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. The month of May is especially important in the history of the Jews of Ashkenaz in particular, primarily because of its association with the horrific Crusades. A series of massacres happened in context of the Crusades in 1096, beginning in May, and this reverberates throughout the liturgy of the synagogue in Ashkenazic congregations. For example, the moving Av HaRachamim prayer is recited every Sabbath and evokes the memory of the martyrs associated with the Crusades. So in that context, as I was doing research for an upcoming trip with Kosher Riverboat Cruises on the Seine, I came across some research by Professor Norman Golb, and it led me to some fascinating information about one particular woman and her story associated with the Crusades. I'd like to take you through that right now. So here's a map that shows you the roots of the Crusades, in particular the First Crusade of 1096. And most of the violence occurred in the Rhineland, the traditional homeland of the Ashkenazic Jews. The pretext for the violence was that many of the Crusaders, especially the kind of rabble-rousing hooligans that were attached on to the more formal soldiers, said, "Why are we going all the way to Jerusalem to remove the infidel from their place and free up the region for Christian pilgrims when we have infidels living right here in Europe?" Of course, speaking about the Jews rather than the Muslims in this context. And so there's some terrible, terrible stories of massacres of Ashkenazic Jews choosing to martyr themselves rather than to accept baptism and so on. However, there's comparatively little material for massacres outside of the Rhineland. And so there's a question that this particular document that I'm going to show you in a moment may involve some violence in the south of France, which was rather unusual. Now, here's the document in question. It's from the Cairo Geniza, which we've discussed on many occasions, is this phenomenal medieval trove of fragmentary documents that were collected in Fustat, or Old Cairo, and they can include all kinds of fascinating historical data about the Jews of the entire Mediterranean basin. This particular document describes the story of one French noblewoman who converted to Judaism and then ran afoul of the Crusaders. It was first published in 1931 by Jacob Mann, shown here, who did a lot of really pioneering work on Geniza documents. He described how this particular letter was the story of a French noblewoman, very wealthy family. She moved to Narbonne, she converted to Judaism, and there she met a young man named Rabbi David of the Todros family. They were married and they had a family there, but her brothers and other members of her family pursued her, and so she and her family fled, which says a lot of interesting things about relations between Jews and non-Jews in general, but not so much for this brief video. Now, an important question is, where did they flee to? Narbonne is in the south of France, but we have a problem because of what Dr. Ben Outhwaite, the head of the Geniza Research Unit of Cambridge, calls the pesky hole right in the middle of the document. And if you see right at the very top of that hole, there are partial letters of a place, Kahal, and then it says something. What does that mean? When Professor Mann read this, he thought it must mean the town of Anjou. He tried to fit in the letters, and he associated with Anjou, which is a little bit further north from Narbonne. Dr. Outhwaite, however, who, by the way, is a very nice guy, I had a correspondence with him in the context of doing this research, and he wrote a brilliant article, which I'll include the link to in the notes for this video, that summarized a lot of the challenges that came to Dr. Mann's association of this place with Anjou. It's most likely not Anjou, but one of two other possible places. Professor Golb, who wrote a tremendous book on the Jews of Normandy, which is how I came to this particular document, he pieces together the place name to read Monieu, as you can see here in this reconstruction from Dr. Outhwaite's work. Now, that's a pretty good assessment. It looks a lot like he's done it correctly, but we have to bear in mind a few tricky things. For example, Hebrew, as many of you I'm sure are aware, is typically written without vowels, which means that with just the consonants, you have lots of different possible pronunciations of any given word. This is why the bar mitzvah ritual is so difficult. We challenge our adolescents with this task of reading the Torah text itself without any vowels, and we see how they do in an audience of adults. Now, there are also additional problems, like, for example, place names change. It is very frequent for one place to have several names, like Byzantium, Constantinople, Istanbul, all the same place. Also, ethnic names of places. The town which is today called Lviv, which is, by the way, pronounced also Lviv, used to be called Lvov by Poles, Lemberg by Germans, Lemberick in Yiddish. So, you know, the same place can have very different names. And finally, just to make it a little more complicated, French pronunciation does not always correspond to its spelling. So the place name Monieu, for example, has an X at the end. What is that X doing there? It could be that the X was actually pronounced in some medieval French, and it is actually preserved in some French places even today. But the letters that Professor Golb has referred to here does not include the letter X, which just adds more complication to the difficulty of actually figuring out where this event happened. However, to return to our story of the French noblewoman, who, by the way, is not named in this document or any other document that we have, she and her family, after having fled Narbonne, unfortunately came into the clutches of apparently the Crusaders involved in one of the many attacks on Jewish populations. Her husband was in the synagogue and he was murdered there. He was apparently with their son Jacob and a three-year-old daughter named Justa, or perhaps pronounced Justa, and the two children were kidnapped by the Crusaders. Presumably they were baptized and they were never heard from again. David's wife, however, our heroine, survived, possibly because she was pregnant, although losing her family and losing all of her wealth left her penniless, and that's actually the subject of the document describing her plight and imploring the Jewish community to have mercy on her and to support her. Now, let us go back to the question of where did this happen, because that has, you know, greater significance for the story, and as we shall see, provides us an opportunity to continue the story. When Professor Gold shifted the location from Anjou to Monieu, it actually was big enough news that it made the New York Times in 1966, which I think is remarkable. I mean, this is a fairly arcane discovery by a Jewish history scholar, but it says something, I think, about the generation of 1960s that people really cared about such things in the broader world. But the New York Times was not alone. The dramatic story of this French noblewoman and her persecution at the hands of her family first and then later at the hands of the Crusaders actually inspired a couple of really significant literary expressions. There was a play called Sibylla that was written in the 1980s, and then this very important book called The Convert, which was originally published in Flemish and then translated into English, became a finalist for the National Jewish Book Award. Fascinating kind of expression of this in the artistic world. However, there's still a problem with the place, because up until now, we've been working with Professor Golb's theory that she fled from Narbonne with her family to Monieu, and that's where they ended up meeting Crusaders. Two other researchers from the Hebrew University, Professor Edna Engel and Yosef Yahalom, separately worked on these two fragments from the Geniza archives, which are clearly written in the same hand, written by the very same scribe. And although they're very badly damaged, they also appear to talk about the same woman. And they describe more things that happened to her. Apparently, she was seized and the Crusaders were preparing to burn her at the stake. This is possibly because she was originally of Christian origin and perhaps they wanted to mete out a special punishment for her, but it gives us a sense of the general scope of the violence at the time. The Jewish community was ordered by the Crusaders to prepare a funereal shroud for her, to wrap her in so they could burn her in that shroud. But At the last moment, the community was able to get together and raise a very large bribe to pay off the Crusaders who agreed to allow her to live. And that's how she survived this act of violence. It appears that this may have been the same act of violence described in the earlier document, although it's not impossible to imagine it's a second one. If we go back to that pesky hole, you can see that with this reconstruction, it could have been vowelized Munyo, which is not at all the same place as Monieu. Monieu is in France, Munyo is in Spain, and both places are actually quite likely locations for Jewish refugees for several reasons. So if we look at the map as a whole, here's our possibilities. You can see that she comes probably from Normandy, quite possibly from the city of Rouen, and she moved down to Narbonne in the south of France, where she married and had a family. Then, according to Professor Mann, they fled to Anjou, and that's where they met the Crusaders. According to Professor Golb, they moved to Monieu, also in the south of France. But according to Professors Engel and Yahalom, which is beginning to become the scholarly consensus, it's much more likely they moved to Munyo. It appears that this noble woman who converted to Judaism decided to give up on Europe altogether, moving to the large and prosperous Jewish community just outside Cairo in a place called Fustat. And it is there that she sought additional support from the Jewish community, and she most likely ended her days there because her documents were ultimately surrendered to the Geniza, where they were found today. So this story tells us a tremendous amount about the experience of one specific individual in the Crusades. It gives us a description of how widespread the violence must have been at that time, and it confirms a lot of the other accounts that we have of the brutality of the violence of that era. And by correcting the possible place in which this occurred, this also represents the correction of what Dr. Outhwaite called an historical libel against this remote and predominantly peaceful corner of France. This is a picture of Monieu itself. But when all said and done, we really have to reflect on the tantalizing few details we have of one woman's life and her experience with the Crusades. I hope you found this video interesting. Thank you very much for watching.